What's up, guys? Dr. Gabrielle Lyon here and Dr. Donald Layman. And if you had just heard right before what we were talking when we were not recording, Don Layman, yes, Don Layman said hypertrophy is fun. So that's what we're going to talk about. There is a lot of information out there about growing muscle. And if you just sit back and think about it, what is hypertrophy? Don't leave yet. I'm going to lay out a couple things. Ribosomal biogenesis. Now you've already clicked off this video. Protein accretion, satellite cells, muscle damage, and amino acids. Okay, you made it through. Five things. We're just going to talk really quickly about hypertrophy and how important it is. And it's actually highly complex. I did get a question on one of a recent interview that I did. They asked me on a cellular level what happens. And I was like, oh my God, where in that pocket? Where is the biochemical pathway chart? It is really complex. We work hard to oversimplify this stuff, but if you actually pull out what happens on a mechanistic or pathway level, it is down the rabbit hole, but not for Don Layman and other mechanistic scientists, but for a practitioner and a very novice scientist, right?
Yeah, we have a lot of issues in how we make the measurements. And so the cellular measurements, we know kind of mechanisms, but we don't know the balance of them. One of the things that you and I have studied is muscle protein synthesis. And we know a lot about ribosomes and initiation factors and mTOR and all of those kinds of things. But the other half of that equation is protein breakdown. And we know sort of the basic mechanisms of lysosomes and things of that nature, but we don't know how to balance those two. And the reality is we have really pretty poor measurements of both of them. We have some kind of specific measures of protein synthesis, but they're very short term. And so you're talking about a 24-hour balance where we make sort of net change effects. And we don't know how to measure protein breakdown at all. And so the issue is hypertrophy has to be a net synthesis bigger than breakdown.
Right.
That's obvious, I guess. but how to achieve that? If you look at children, that system is anabolic because of hormones.
Mm.
You can have a really poor diet and children will still grow.
Right.
Sort of a survival, evolutionary survival. They may not grow as well, but they still grow. Once you get beyond the hormone period, you know, into your 30s, then the rest of your life, now hormones really aren't your pal. They're not controlling it. And now things like resistance exercise, stretch.
Stop at stretch. I never think of stretch as something that relates to hypertrophy, but you do.
Yeah, I do. I'll get back to that one. And the other is the protein. So the balance of your exercise and your protein, total calories really determine your potential for hypertrophy later in life.
Well, that's interesting. So it later in life, so the fitter you are earlier on is better, which obviously makes sense. And I suppose this concept of muscle memory is important, which we should do a separate topic on that, read up on that and kind of discuss that. When it comes to hypertrophy, some people respond better than others, which I think is very interesting. Have you thought about that at all in terms of, is it a fiber type issue? Is it a genetic capacity issue? It is a combination of both. Because you can have two people who train the same, eat the same, and one person grows and the other person doesn't.
Yeah, I don't have a good answer for that really at all. I mean, that's absolutely clear. We know that the resistance exercise part and how you do that and how you know, the volume, the load you use will have an impact, but it clearly is different between different people. And, you know, that's true for metabolism. I mean, two people can eat the same amount of calories and one will be okay and the other will gain weight and a third would lose weight. So we know there are differences in metabolic efficiency. We know that some people are born with more fast fiber types, and some people are born with more slow fiber types. That's why you have world champion weightlifters and you have world champion marathon runners.
And this is also one of the reasons why muscle is so difficult to test and address, is that, you know, we talk a lot about muscle-centric medicine, muscle-centric health. I was talking to Faden, someone who was a PhD in my lab when I was at Sam Klein's lab at Wash U, and Faden Magos. He's an amazing author. It's M-A-G-K-O-S. He's written tons of papers. One of the things that we were talking about is he said, you know, Gabrielle, fat is easy to address and measure because it's homogeneous. Typically the white fat, you look at white fat from this biopsy to that biopsy, it's the same. But muscle is so much more complex, and the fiber types and the biopsies, all of it. I remember when I was doing biopsies at Wash U, some individuals would have really meaty biopsies and others, their skeletal muscle was really mushy. You know, so there's heterogeneous.
That's a whole area of sarcopenia, but you know, the fiber types are quite different, and the kind of activity, you know, you do affects it, but there's a genetic part. You mentioned satellite cells. We know that satellite cells differ across types. We know it differ across people.
And age.
All kinds of things affect that, which is your ability to build muscle or repair muscle, all those kinds of things. So it's something we don't know. And you mentioned, or I mentioned earlier about stretch. We think about resistance exercise, and I think the average person thinks about hypertrophy of muscle, and it's the lifting part, the concentric part of exercise. But there's a lot of research that indicates the eccentric side, the stretch part, actually has as much to do.
Now I understand what you mean by stretch.
So, you know, there was research back when I was in grad school, and we were looking at things like casting of muscles. And we know that if you break a limb and cast your muscles, it tends to atrophy. But there was a lot of research done that showed that if you cast a muscle like in your arm and you cast the biceps, you know, contracted, the triceps, the backside would be stretched, that would actually hypertrophy in the cast.
Oh, interesting.
And while the biceps, the one that's contracted, will atrophy. And so we tend to cast neutrally. And so both atrophy, you know, I think it's a good indication. And I think people who do resistance exercise and trainers understand that you do a slow eccentric motion. You don't want to just do the concentric and drop it. That's not the best way. So I think people understand that the nerve ending and the stretch part are part of that hypertrophy mechanism.
That is very fascinating. So this is not to discourage someone from lifting weights. You still, you know, you need to train, you need to get the volume in. There's a lot of things that also affect hypertrophy. I was reading.
I would just interrupt you for that statement. One thing that we should also encourage people is things like yoga and Pilates.
I am not telling that. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
Actually, for the average adult who isn't interested in going to the gym, those things are very important for muscle health to maintain. You might not hypertrophy the muscle, but it keeps it in an anabolic state so you don't lose it. So one doesn't want to ignore kind of the lower resistance kinds of things because they're very important for muscle health.
Okay. There you go. Yoga, resistance exercise. You know, I was looking at one study, and it was the concept of, I think it was a bird, B-U-R-D-E. I'll have to look.
Probably Nick Bird.
Yes. I think that is the author. And he was talking about, or the study, the paper was talking about, that obese individuals have a blunted anabolic response. And they also have a blunted anabolic response to hypertrophy. Well, no, more muscle protein synthesis, and then
remember that paper. I couldn't quote it to you, but I think I'm pretty sure you're right. It was Nick Bird. He was at the University of Illinois.
Yes. And I thought that that was quite eye-opening, that, you know, for some people, hypertrophy is an uphill battle. And I see that in clinical practice. It is an absolute uphill battle, you know.
I mean, we know a lot of the mechanisms, but the interaction, one of the things that I always like to show people is when you look at like the mTOR regulation, it's regulated by leucine, amino acids. It's regulated by hormones. So insulin, IGF-1 do have an impact. It's regulated by exercise, stretch through it, RED1, and it's regulated by energy through AMP kinase.
Right.
So all four of those things have to balance correctly. And in an obese individual, you already have dysregulation of at least three of those factors.
Right. Right. That's an excellent point. An excellent point that there is dysregulation in the obesogenic setting. Mm-hmm. So, all right, guys, I hope you found this conversation interesting. We won't extend it any longer, although we would love to. If you would like longer videos, please let us know, because Don and I can go on for easily an hour. Like, subscribe, please share. And we know how busy you are, and we really appreciate your time. So thanks again.